Welcome everyone to Kolot Nashim, Jewish music by women composers, a virtual concert and conversation. Joining me as co-host, I'm pleased to welcome from Chicago, Maestra Lidia Yankovskaya. Former Zamir assistant conductor, she is founder and artistic director of the Refugee Orchestra Project and now music director of the Chicago Opera Theater. Hi, Lidia.
Hi, Josh. So thrilled to be here and to be part of this wonderful program. As you know, for many centuries, professional music making in the Western world has been largely limited, with women and non-white composers and performers highly uncommon at prominent mainstream institutions in Europe and America. It was nearly impossible for women composers to have their works published or heard on concert stages. For performers, here, the Boston Symphony Orchestra led the way accepting female musicians after 1914, but it was 1966 before the New York Philharmonic brought on its first female member, and several major European orchestras did not allow women until the 80s or 90s. Likewise, in most churches, synagogues, and mosques, the voice of a woman was strictly forbidden. And until 1975, there were no women formally invested as cantors. For centuries, Kol Isha, the voice of a woman, was suppressed. Now we're presenting Kolot Nashim, the voices of many women, restoring them to their deserved position.
Tonight, we are presenting part one of a series of programs exploring the roles women have played in Jewish music, a program that was postponed from last spring. The pandemic inspired us to reconfigure the program and create this virtual concert experience. Tonight, we will explore music by Nurit Hirsch, Alice Parker, Meira Warschauer, and Molly Pican. Tonight's program is dedicated to the memory of Linda Plaut, the City of Newton's longtime Director of Cultural Affairs and founder of the Newton Festival of the Arts.
Good evening, I'm Mayor Ruth Ann Fuller, and on behalf of the City of Newton, I'm grateful that the Zamir Chorale is presenting this program to share music and bring us together, especially at a time when we're so apart. This evening's program is special in so many ways. Terrific Jewish music by women composers, a wonderful commemoration of the 100th anniversary of the 19th Amendment with a poignant tribute to the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg and a heartwarming dedication to Newton's own Linda Plaut, our beloved Director of Cultural Affairs. Thank you for dedicating this gathering to Linda, as she loved that the arts have the power, whether in person or through pixels, to bring us together and make us one. Thank you from all of us in the City of Newton.
My name is Linda Plaut, and I'm the director of the Mayor's Office for Cultural Affairs. It's so nice to see so many of you. Next year, for the month of May, we're doing a huge Festival of the Arts all over Newton for the entire month of May, featuring the individuals and the organizations that really make Newton the culturally rich community that it is.
We have 150 individual people on our committee, 94 separate events, 26 different locations across Newton, including 9 pianos, which have just been put out in 9 locations in each of the villages.
Oh,
Many of Israel's greatest songwriters were and are women. One of them is Nurit Hirsch, the award-winning composer of Boker Shel Zahav, with which we started our program, and about 1,000 other songs, including Oseh Shalom Bimromav and Bashana Haba'a. Recently, I had a delightful conversation with Nurit. Here's a brief excerpt. Oh, and by the way, you can find the full conversation with Nurit on Zamir's website, zamir.org. We are delighted and honored to have with us the distinguished composer and songwriter Nurit Hirsch. You've won the Israel Prize, among many other honors. You've composed over 1,000 songs for both adults and children, some of which have become classics, including Bashana Haba'a, Oseh Shalom, Perach Halilach, and Abba Nibi, which won the first prize in the 1978 Eurovision Song Contest. You've composed music for films and stage, including the great film Salah Shabbat. We're doing this as part of a series on women in Jewish music. And one of the things that we are discovering is that for many women, a career in music was very difficult in what was a male-dominated profession, certainly until recent years. Did you encounter any obstacles in your career for being a woman?
I remember only one time. And when I did Salah Shabbati, the band were the rhythm section, and they didn't like me to tell them what to do. They made jokes, and they behaved not very well. But this was the only case. During all my long career, I didn't feel professional discrimination. When I recorded in the studio classical music with the Philharmonic Orchestra players, they respected me, they saw the score, they were colleagues. I didn't feel discrimination. I was lucky.
That's wonderful.
Yes.
You think that's more so in Israel than other countries?
Today, I don't think so. Today, everything changed.
Yes.
But up till today, I'm the only, it's not modest to say, but it's the truth, that I'm still the only woman who composes and arranges for orchestra and conduct and recording, a producer. I produced many records, not only mine. And I and another woman are the only two women through the long history of the Eurovision who conducted the orchestra and orchestrated the symphonic orchestra. Why? I don't have an answer.
Well, you know, you alluded to the many different aspects of your career. How do you manage it? How do you juggle all these aspects of your career as a musician, both classical and popular, composing, conducting, orchestrating?
I like to juggle. I get bored easily. I want to expand. I want to do everything. I love every kind of music. Classical, opera, chazanut.
How do you compose? I mean, how do you get started when you're writing a song, either on a commission or if you have your own idea? How does the muse come to you? What inspires you? Do you ever get stuck when you're trying to compose?
There is no answer for this miracle. It's a secret. It's a miracle. I have no explanation how the inspiration comes from. Just an idea pops into my mind out of the blue, usually in the morning. I'm a morning person. And I write it on notes, or I record it in my little tape recorder to, I don't want to forget. And then I work on it until I am happy. This is how I do it.
So the piece that Zamir has performed that began this program is Boker Shel Zahav. Did Chalfi write the lyrics for you? Did you discover his poem? Did the melody come first? What happened in that case?
I started to be famous, and my songs were on the radio, and he came to me and he showed me the text. That's all how it happened. I liked the lyrics. There were so, he was older, much older than me, but there was something like young and childish in him, in Shimshon Halfi. It was so young and fresh and vibrant. I immediately composed it. And I must confess that this song has many performances. The best, honestly, the best is the Zamir Boston. It's the best of the best. It's so perfect. And you conduct it perfect.
That makes this interview worthwhile right now.
Yes, and it's the
Thank
truth.
You. Thank yeah. you. Your song is very optimistic. Boca Shel Zahav.
I am an optimistic person. I am very optimistic. Yes.
So you have written many songs with lyrics from the Bible and from the Tfilot, from the prayers, Hose Shalom, Tzion Halotish Ali, Shirat Devorah, many others. Tell us, what role does Jewish tradition play in your life and in your music?
It plays a main role. Since my early childhood, when I was 2 years old, I lived with my grandparents because we didn't have money to buy an apartment. So we lived together, and I heard the Chazanut and the Tfilot and Leila Seder. What you learn in your early childhood stays with you forever, for the rest of your life. I love Chazanut.
We have to mention this song that you wrote, Hose Shalom. This song that is sung by Jews all around the world, and they think it's part of the traditional tefillot.
I didn't dream it will
spread its wings.
Spread its wings to the whole wide world. And a year and a half ago, I was in New York. I went to a show, Come From Away, a wonderful show, musical. Yeah. It's theater and musical together. Many Tony Awards. Suddenly I hear my song, 4 minutes, Hose Shalom Bimroma. They thought it was a folk song, old, ancient folk song. Am I so ancient? I like people to sing my songs. I don't care. I never took money for composing a song. Never.
So what's it been like for you in this past half a year during the pandemic? Have you been able to continue making music by yourself with others? What's it like?
Usually I perform 40 or 50 concerts a year, which is a lot. Mm-hmm. Most of the concerts are in elementary schools. I initiated a program which is called Sharim Moreshet, Singing Heritage, for studying a love of Israel, heritage, democracy. Up till today, I performed in 750 schools in Israel. Wow. And about 600,000 children studied my songs. They study my songs about half a year in advance. And then I come and I host the show and I sing and tell in short stories about the songs. And the children perform. They dance, they play, they do theater. Every school, according to the inspiration of the children. I miss seeing the little children. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I miss it.
So I'm going to ask you a favor. For our audience that heard us sing Boca Shel Zahav.
Yes.
Could we hear what it sounds like when you sing it?
It's not interesting in comparison to the Zamir Boston.
But the authenticity of it.
Bye.
wonderful pianist and a wonderful singer as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nurit, thank you so much. You have been so sweet, easy to talk to, and I'm very grateful for your silence, from your time, and for your music.
Yes, thank you from all my heart. Yes.
All right.
Bye-bye.
So, Lydia, can you tell our viewers something about your experience in Zamir and what you're doing now in your career?
Being part of Zamir Chorale was a very important and formative experience for me. I joined Zamir as the assistant conductor and also sang in the chorus straight out of undergrad as I was doing my graduate studies at Boston University. And for me, in addition to the experience I got conducting and singing in the ensemble, also were essential the regular sessions I had with Josh studying Jewish repertoire. There is so much amazing music that has been overlooked in our culture, in our society, and our music history, but that is some of the most beautiful music ever written. And I still reference this music regularly. I still think about the works that Josh and I studied, and it has inspired me to dig more deeply into all kinds of repertoire in my own work now.
And what was it like going into a career that for centuries was totally male-dominated?
I think the hardest part was not having any role models, any people who were like me. I felt often that I had to forge my own path because I didn't know of others who looked like me or who had a similar background to me doing what I wanted to do. Of course, I came across a few people in early on who thought that women shouldn't conduct in general, but none of them could give me a good reason for these opinions, which was encouraging. But in general, I think ultimately I try now to make sure that I have an opportunity to mentor emerging conductors and composers and others who are less represented in the field. The hardest thing, I think, for anyone who is from a minority group is to get their foot in the door in the first place, to get the opportunities to be noticed and, more importantly, to gain valuable and essential skills. And so I now make sure that when possible, I give those opportunities to others.
Great. And do you make an effort to program music by women composers?
Absolutely. I think it's very important as a conductor or anyone in the position to program to be aware of the great work that is out there by women, by people of color, from people of all backgrounds. I think so often in our mainstream culture, we overlook some really essential works, some works that are some of the most powerful music that's out there. And as conductors, I feel that we have a responsibility to do the research, to dig deeply, to find those who have been overlooked and to bring them to light.
Thanks, Lydia. And now we have a real treat. One of America's most beloved composers of vocal music is Alice Parker. We're going to be hearing Alice's composition, An American Kedusha, from Zamir's performance at an interfaith concert in 2001. In fact, the concert took place on this very date, November 17th, 2001. But first, let's meet Alice Parker. So, we are delighted to have with us Alice Parker, renowned conductor and composer and arranger, who is about to celebrate her 95th birthday in December, if I'm getting that right.
Unbelievable.
You were born in Boston and attended New England Conservatory, which is also my alma mater. A composer of so much music, but we might say primarily vocal music, operas, song cycles, hymns, and of course the many folk song arrangements that you arranged, some of which for the Robert Shaw Chorale. You're the founder of Melodious Accord, a wonderful educational program with its attached performing ensemble. You have received so many honors, I won't even list them here.
Please don't.
But you are an enabler, and I have seen you in action as a promoter of singing, of having everybody sing, and not just from sheet music, and focusing on melody and the ability to improvise and improvise harmony. And that is something I greatly appreciate. But we're here to talk about an American Kedusha, a piece that you wrote, I believe, in 1999. And I wonder if you can tell us something about the genesis of the piece. How did you come to write this piece? I believe it was a commission.
It was a commission, unlikely as it seems, from the American Guild of Organists. And they asked me to write the piece to be performed at their annual convention in 2000. And it was to be a choral piece with or without accompaniment. They did not specify that they needed organ. They did suggest a text that they wanted me to set, which was the L'Ador V'Ador. And I thought, well, I don't know that at all. I need to find out about that. So I accepted the commission for a kind of a 3-minute anthem. And then I called my good friend, Eleanor Epstein, who sets me straight on all things Jewish, and asked her, what's this text? And she said, oh, that's not a text by itself. That belongs in the Kedusha. And I said, well, what's the Kedusha, being totally ignorant? So she promptly sent me the whole text of the Hebrew. And I said, well, I need a word by word translation so that I know what I'm doing. So she sent me that. And I very soon realized that there was no way I could write a 3-minute piece on L'Ador V'Ador. It's over in a flash unless you just keep repeating it over and over, which it calls for, of course. But she also put me onto this wonderful folk song melody. And the whole thing began to be possible for me when she brought that, because it's exactly the lift of energy in the middle of the piece that it needs. But I got so taken by this gorgeous text. Of course, very familiar, much of it to me from our Bible, the King James translation. And so I got thinking, well, I have to make my connection with this Hebrew, and that I need to know it very well. I need to know how it sounds. So Eleanor, bless her heart, made a very careful tape of her speaking the text. So she prepared this for me, and I, as I was working on it, I thought, well, really, ideally, what I need is an English translation that exactly matches not the meaning of each syllable, but the sound of the syllable, so that I can get an English phrase which exactly matches the Hebrew. Well, that's a huge job, of course. Nekadesh et shimcha v'olam shemakdishim odo And as I was working on it, it became very clear to me that I had to have a cantor and a chorus, and that it seemed to me at this point in our lives, I needed two cantors. I needed a man and a woman, so that I now have three performing voices, a man soloist, a woman soloist, and the chorus, and that I could trade the Hebrew text back and forth between any of them. They're all equal. Or the English text. So you get all different kinds of combinations of one cantor doing Hebrew and the other one doing English and the chorus doing one or the other behind. All the different possible permutations of that. So your ear is constantly kind of awakened by moving from one voice to another. Another thing was the chant places that come between, that are just beautiful, that I tried to base those totally on the rhythms that Eleanor spoke to me, so that I was working from the Hebrew rhythms.
It sounds Jewish, I have to say. Both the traditional Jewish melody that you used and the chant. You really were able to get the essence of Jewish chant in the section at the beginning and the end of the piece.
I'm so glad, yeah.
You have done a lot of work, of course, with folk songs and folk song arrangements, and you've done a few other Hebrew pieces as well. Can you tell us about those?
Yes, these again come from commissions for Elmer, for her chorus, which I really love being with and hearing, and the way she works with them. And these were all things that she selected because she needed materials for her chorus. But she gave me such titles as Dorme, Dorme, which has to be one of the most gorgeous melodies ever. But then the marvelous dances like Yesusum, that are just so, they just bring you into it. And again, with all of these, I have to memorize the language that I'm setting and do it over and over. And I pretend I'm a different person saying it. Suppose I'm somebody that's just in the heat of action and I'm doing this, or somebody that is really sitting by themselves and pondering deeply, how would I read this? So you read it, read the text in many different ways and find the one that just sticks in the back of my mind.
So we're doing this as part of a program about women in Jewish music. One of the questions that I'm asking is, when you were entering the profession, there were not very many women conductors or composers. What were some of the challenges that you remember, and how did you overcome these challenges?
I don't remember exclusion. I was lucky enough to grow in a family where my parents were very firm about, there were five of us, girls and boys, and we all were subjected to the same regime. There was no difference. There was no boys' jobs and girls' jobs. We all did everything, and we were expected not only to do everything, but to do everything well. So it was a very high standard. So when I was taking piano lessons when I was 8 and decided I want to write a piece, they encouraged me. Therefore, I don't notice the closed door so much as the fact that it's there and I'm going to find a way around it, yeah.
Alice, is there anything else that you would like to add?
No, just thanks to the Jewish community for accepting me so wonderfully. I just have been so enriched by, as I am by, when I come in contact with wonderful melodies from anywhere, but this whole tradition. And I belong to a Bible study group and have always been active in our church, but I'm so totally indebted to the background that comes from your people. I could easily be Jewish.
We'll make you an honorary Jewess.
All right. The Mennonites did that for me too. I considered that was lovely. So thank you very much, Josh. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Alice. The pleasure is mine, and I wish you good health and in advance a very happy birthday.
Thank you very much, Josh. And continue, you're the first one.
Continue your wonderful work for many years.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
We will
sanctify your name.
And in that way, on way.
Thank you.
such a great pleasure to hear Zamir perform again after all these years. The timing of our program coincides with the centenary of a milestone for women's rights in the United States. The suffragette movement and the passing of the 19th Amendment finally giving women the right to vote. It is important to note that many Black women were still not able to vote after the ratification because the amendment did not eliminate state laws that kept many Black people from voting. Also, at this time, still on our minds and in our hearts is the memory of the trailblazing Ruth Bader Ginsburg, a true lover of music and especially of opera. Aleha HaShalom.
And now we're going to have a world premiere performance. A virtual world premiere performance. Meira Warshauer, a resident of Columbia, South Carolina, is an award-winning composer whose works have been performed by orchestras throughout the United States as well as in Eastern Europe. One reviewer wrote, quote, Warshauer's music is shot through with and inspired by mystical and spiritual matters that span a love and respect for Mother Earth and the Jewish faith, unquote. So here now is my conversation with Meira, followed by the premiere performance of her composition, Place These Words. Hello, Meira. I'm delighted that you have adapted a version of your major choral symphony, Ahava, into a standalone piece for choir, soprano solo, piano, cello, and percussion. It is so beautiful, so atmospheric. Can you tell us something about how the piece came to be? What inspired you?
So I just actually made a short video telling that story.
Great. All right, let's watch that now.
In June of 1991, I was on the campus of Bryn Mawr College in Pennsylvania. I was there for a Jewish renewal retreat, and I was teaching a class on Judaism and the environment, and we were setting text to music. So one day early in the week, I was out davening my afternoon prayers, the mincha service, and I found a meadow, a beautiful meadow, place overlooking a meadow. And when I finished my prayers, I turned around, and behind me was this magnificent beech tree. And I was really drawn to the beech tree. So I went over and I kind of wrapped my hands or arms around her. It's the kind of so big that it would take three of me to wrap completely around the trunk. And I was just like, felt so good to be with this beech tree. And I looked up and somehow a question emerged. Do you have a song for me? And pretty soon I heard the sound. Ahava. 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 Ahava is the Hebrew word for love. So I knew this was really special. And it felt like the tree was just emanating love to me, and like the tree maybe had always been emanating love to all of us, to all of creation, and that not only was the tree emanating love, but probably all of creation was emanating love.
Wow, that is so beautiful. So our program is dealing with the challenges that women musicians have faced. Were there obstacles that you had to overcome to become a composer, performer?
When I was growing up, I didn't see any role models for, not that I even thought of it. I didn't even think about possibly being a composer. You know, women were not really allowed to be in the expressive arts, even in visual arts. I mean, you look at Georgia O'Keeffe, who is such an icon, and she was pegged as a woman artist, which she resisted, and she struggled to be recognized for her art. I was born at a time, the women's movement in the early 70s was throughout the Boston area, and we had, you know, consciousness raising groups. Assertiveness training was one of the things we did. You know, how to stand up for yourself, how to stand up inside for yourself, to be who you could be. And it gave me, you know, it opened up possibilities inside of, to do whatever I wanted. And then the other thing, though, that I really have to say brought me to composing was meditating. I learned how to do transcendental meditation. So combined with the women's movement and the spiritual awakening, I would go into that zone with the meditating, and this music would just come out. And that was who I needed to be. And luckily for me, it was at a time when it was just the beginning of the opening of more and more women. It's just, that's the way it is. And so when all the people who are in the position of power or presenters or are mostly men, it's a little different.
Let me pick up on something that you said before. I think you said you don't want to be known as a woman composer because that could be restrictive. But do you think of yourself in any way as a woman composer? Do you think that there's some sound of your music that sounds like music by a woman? Is there a difference between music by men composers and women composers? Just as we would say, oh, that sounds Jewish. Is there something that sounds feminine?
Well, I think the answer to that is no. I don't think there's a female sound. However, you know, people talk about a feminine aspect and a male aspect. And I think the creative aspect is more, to me, it's more of a female aspect. I was playing Chopin last night, and he's a huge influence, especially in my piano writing. And it's just such a sensitivity. I don't know, it's not written by a woman. However, there may be something, and I hate to say a stereotype because I don't think it's true, but there's something about the Mother Earth. We talk about Mother Earth, and La Tierra in Spanish is a female. Hadama in Hebrew is feminine. Yeah. Okay, so there's something, so much of my work is inspired by the earth. So there may be something with that I just feel such a grounding connection. And then there's the fertility aspect and the womb aspect that I think there may be something in there that a woman, that I as a woman connect with differently. So that's beyond the sensitivity part. It's more the physical experience of having a physical body and what that does to the way we perceive and what we want to communicate.
What about you as a Jewish composer? You've had a return to Judaism. What role has that played in your music and your creativity?
That's been huge. It's been pivotal. I was like a schizophrenic composer. I had some pieces that were like in the minor mode that were like my Jewish pieces. And I wanted something that combined everything. So I found that in the Jewish modes. And it was authentic. I wasn't borrowing somebody else's. It was mine. I loved it. It was mine. And I loved learning about it. So it just fundamentally, it influenced my language. And it gave me a way to be as expressive as I needed to. Especially I wanted to really get back to Ahava. I looked in the liturgy and I saw the prayer, the blessing before the Shema ends with the word Ahava, the Ahava, that God is choosing us with love. And then we sing, or then comes the declaration of faith, of unity, that there is one God, and that's our God, Shema. And right after that, V'ahavta, and you shall love this God, you shall love your God. And it's like your God is love. The second paragraph after the Shema, which starts with, again, with, and you shall love and teach to your children, beware lest you fall, go astray and fall and bow to alien gods. And you lose everything. You lose who you are. You lose your land. You are banished from the earth. So don't do that. Don't go there. This is a warning, which we're living. But don't go there. Come back. Come back to this heart. Place these words upon your heart and teach them diligently unto your children. Bind them on your hand. Place them between your eyes. Speak of them at home or on the way, wherever you go, whatever door you go through. Ahava, just remember it. Love, just love, love, love. And this is the thing that just sends me, so that you may live, you and your children, on the land which God gave to your ancestors. For as long as the heavens are over the earth. And I just tear up, because we've inherited this beautiful earth. So the reason I love going back to the Jewish tradition is there's always a hope. Because we have no other choice. If we don't have hope, we might as well not continue. And we're going to continue because we're always just choosing life. That's what we're told to do. Choose life, choose life. And so with my music, I'm always thinking of that. I could go on and on about the earth.
Anything else you'd like to add, Meira?
I just want to thank you and Zamir and for honoring me with this performance and sharing this passion for the Jewish tradition, the Jewish musical tradition, and what it has to teach us, not only as Jews, but as the whole of humanity. What can our tradition bring to the world? And for me, I feel like it's a calling. And I feel like you share the calling of bringing beauty and meaning to the world through music.
Well, thank you, Meira. It's been delightful talking to you, and I thank you for your time and especially for your music.
Thank you, Josh.
Speak. Good evening. My name is Joyce Bonin, and I am an alumna, former board chair, supporter, and longtime fan of the Zamir Chorale of Boston. I hope you are enjoying Kolot Nashim. For over 50 years, Zamir has brought the joy of Jewish music to homes and performance stages around the world, from 19th century European synagogues to the chants of Yemen to the songs of Israel, and from contemporary American jazz to the much-loved tunes of the Yiddish theater, Zamir has consistently set the bar for musical excellence. Zamir relies on donations from its fans. Won't you join me to help keep Jewish music alive? Please donate now by visiting zamir.org. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy the remainder of the concert.
For much of the 20th century, Molly Picon was an iconic actor and singer in the Yiddish theater and later film, Broadway, and television. One of her greatest roles was in the 1936 Yiddish film, Yiddle Mitten Fiddle. Although she was already 38 years old, she portrays a teenage violinist on the road with her father. For safety reasons, she has to dress up as a boy, as at that time, girls generally were not allowed on the road and not accepted as professional musicians. Complications arise when she falls in love with an itinerant musician who doesn't realize that she is a woman. Here is the song she sings about falling in love. Oy Mama, Am I in Love? It was composed by Abe Elstein, but Molly probably had a hand in its creation and certainly in its popularity. You'll see a much younger version of myself singing this piece while I was working with Zamir and still doing some singing.
So you take the role of Molly Picon in this performance. And Lydia, your partner in this performance was the violinist Dan Stepner. And Dan is one of the most sought-after violinists in the Boston area. He is artistic director of the Aston Magna Festival and Foundation, professor emeritus at Brandeis University, and for 24 years, he was concertmaster of the Handel and Haydn Society Orchestra. So here's Dan remembering our performance.
Hello, Josh and Lydia. Thank you for asking me to reminisce about our collaboration on Oy Mama some years ago at Sanders Theater. And a shout out to my brother Mark, who's been a member of the Zamir Chorale for many years. I've been very fortunate to be able to make my living as a classical violinist, playing chamber music, recitals, teaching. And so a chance to do a klezmer or gypsy turn comes along very seldom, but it's always great fun when it does. It reminds me of my roots. Both sets of my grandparents came from Eastern Europe. My father's from Poland, my mother's from Ukraine. In fact, my very first violin belonged to my paternal grandfather. And of course, the text of Oy Mama is a violinist's dream. Imagine a Shana Madel, a beautiful young woman, falling in love with a violinist, presumably because of his playing. Lydia, I remember exchanging smiling glances with you as we performed the piece, and it wasn't just mugging for the audience. It was a real pleasure. For me, it was just one rehearsal and one performance, and it was over in a flash. But the memory remains vivid, and I'm so glad we have it on video. Hope you enjoy it.
Mir zugezogen, oi Mama, wohin geht?
We will have more videos, music, and interviews with women composers, scholars, conductors throughout the year. And to watch the complete interviews with the composers, please visit zamir.org. So, goodbye, and thanks for watching.
Menaker et haloni halon.